How's it going, everybody? Welcome to Chemotherapy. If it's your first time checking out this channel, please consider subscribing by clicking that subscribe button down at the bottom. And don't forget to click that little bell on the side so you can get notifications to when I post a new video. Tonight, I'm going to be reviewing the second half of Phantom of the Opera, Love Never Dies. Check it out, the second portion of the Phantom of the Opera. Like, a lot of people was not aware that it was around because it didn't do so well. It never really hit Broadway. It didn't do well when it opened up in London. It closed down after 1 year. And then it went through a revision. A director from Australia said, hey, let me take a crack at it. They rewrote it. And that's the version that we're dealing with now, is the rewrite. Now, despite all those negative reviews and it not doing so well in London, I'm going to go out on a limb and say this. That Love Never Dies is like one step away from being like titanically huge, big like Phantom of the Opera. The costumes that the people in the carnival wore, the way that the lighting was used to make it look like Coney Island. I've never been to Coney Island, but I felt like I was at Coney Island. And the usage of the stage and the blocking, because they're on a turntable stage. Things are moving around in a circle. Actors are having to kind of walk backwards and look at each other while one person is walking one way, the other person is walking backwards, and people are weaving in and out. You put that combined with the lighting and the props that are being used on stage, it's an absolutely fantastic experience. You combine that with the music that Andrew Lloyd Webber puts together for the singers. The lady that played Christine Daae just knocked it out of the park when she sang Love Never Dies. This big peacock background blue. She came out with this blue dress, long satin gloves, and the jewelry she was wearing was fantastic. Her voice punched through, powerful and delicate, combining it with the Phantom of the Opera's strength and how he sings. Even Gustav, the kid that played Gustav, the little kid, really put it together. Now, those are all surface things, and I think for the price of admission, I almost regret sitting up in the cheap seats. I would have, if I knew it was going to be that much of an assault on my senses, I would have loved to sit down on the floor so I could just get that full frontal assault of the lights and the sound from the singers and being able to just witness up close all the wonderful costuming. So all of that is worth the price of admission to sitting on the bottom floor. All right, I'm going to be rolling through some spoilers here on the play. So if you don't want to know what happens in the play, please stop here. But the big thing is the little boy, Gustav, is the Phantom of the Opera's son. So that means if that happened 10 years ago, if he's 10, right, that means in Phantom of the Opera, Christine was messing around with the Phantom. And some people are like, oh, Christine would never cheat on Raoul. First of all, screw Raoul, pretty boy, motherfucker, all right? I'm a Phantom of the Opera guy. He's ugly, deformed, he kills people, he's seductive and mysterious. I want that guy to win. I think that's where the love never dies, from the Phantom of the Opera. But there's a lot of people that say that, oh, if he messed around, if she messed around on Raoul, then the romance from Phantom of the Opera is gone. But I don't really care about that. I want the Phantom of the Opera to win. The Phantom still loves Christine Daae, and that's how they lure both Christine and Raoul over to Manhattan 10 years later. Apparently, Raoul has a drinking and a gambling problem, and they're broke. That's the reason they accept the invitation to go to this mysterious place in Manhattan to perform. And that really comes through. I mean, Raoul is an absolute douchebag in this second half. In fact, he kind of gambles away his right to Christine. They do a little bargain, the Phantom and Raoul, and he ends up losing. You know, so I get that point. Raoul is now a jerk drunk with a gambling problem. The Phantom is still madly in love with Christine. Christine obviously still has feelings for the Phantom. That's the father of her child. But the one relationship I'm going to say that is very important that I think needed to be developed a little bit more is the relationship between Meg and Christine. And if you haven't seen Phantom of the Opera, Meg and Christine are friends. They're dancers in the Phantom of the Opera's opera house. And of course, the story goes, the Phantom takes Christine, ascends her to the top singer and dancer, and then Meg kind of plays second fiddle, second place. But they remain really good friends. Now, after Phantom of the Opera, 10 years later, Meg and her mom go to Manhattan with the Phantom of the Opera. They set up their shop there. And then Meg becomes the number one person. And then all of a sudden, here comes Christine out of nowhere. And on the night that Meg is supposed to be the headliner, Christine comes in and kind of steals that thunder away from her. Now, I get it. The director is kind of shoving it in front of my face that there is some animosity now between Meg and the mom and Christine. Because Meg and the mom are like, I can't believe we stuck with the Phantom for these 10 years and he's finally doing that to us. Now, that's the message that I got. But the way that it was written, it's basically like I just told you, it was shoved in front of your face. There wasn't a lot of emotional character development between the animosity that was supposed to be there between Christine and Meg. And this is an important relationship because at the ending, Meg is so pissed, she kidnaps Gustav and they go looking for her. And at the ending, there's a fight between the Phantom and Meg because Meg's like telling the Phantom, "You never really appreciated me," and blah, 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 blah. Meg pulls out a gun and then it accidentally goes off and Meg shoots Christine. And that's a relationship that needs to be stronger because I didn't feel, even though I knew Meg was mad, I didn't feel like she was mad enough to want to kidnap Gustav at all. So that's a problem for the plot. The only other problem I had was how they decided to kind of kill Christine, and that was by the usage of a gun. And I know the relationship between Christine and Meg didn't really make me feel like they hated each other, even though it was said. I just didn't believe it. The usage of a gun in a story as beautiful as Love Never Dies, it seemed vulgar for them to shoot Christine and have her just kind of die there on the pier. I would rather have her knocked off the pier, have her drown and then disappear and show up in Atlantis and hang out with Jason Momoa or something like that. But I did feel it was just a little bit too vulgar for it to happen in that sense. But director's choice, they wrote the play. I'm not trying to say to rewrite it. I roll with it. I disliked it, but it's part of the play. So if the question is Love Never Dies worth it? I'd say absolutely go and enjoy it. It's going to transport you to a different world. I highly recommend it. I say maybe spend $100, $120 to sit down on the floor and get the full experience. All right, guys, thanks for watching this play review. So if you are on the fence and wondering, should I watch Love Never Dies? I say go for it. Never mind those negative reviews online. It's going to transport you back to the Phantom of the Opera where he made you listen to the music of the night. There are bits and pieces of that score from the Phantom of the Opera that appear throughout the entire play. So go out and check it out. So guys, again, thanks for watching. If you haven't subscribed to the channel, please do like the video as much as possible. Share it with everybody. And remember, I'll catch you guys later.
7654321.
You'll never have the sacred stone.
Oh, this you crazy mother...